you would open your notes, that would be very good. Leading with love. This is probably the reason they asked me to come. And may I say, you do not need to take any notes. You're clear. Because everything I say to you now, I'm shortening, is in the book, Leading with Love. So sit back, relax. You work too hard. You can just enjoy the talk. And it's all there. All the quotes are there and in greater expanse. Just waiting for everyone to get in.
Page 24.
Page 24, the notes to follow me. I've been mentioning to you the Cape Town Lausanne Conference, third international Lausanne Conference with over 5,000 people from every country of the world. And it was a very significant conference, if for no other reason, to get a feel for the evangelical world and how it's doing. Even if you don't agree with everything done there, it was a good barometer. Let me just read a couple statements here because it's so powerful and it's right down the line with what we're talking about. These statements come from assessing the audience and doing surveys with the audience. And the top five pressing issues the church is facing. Now, this is amazing. The top five pressing issues, I would never have guessed this. Most of them revolve around leadership failure. Personal pride. That really shocked me. Second, lack of integrity. Third, spiritual warfare, pressing issue. Corruption, they mean corruption in the church and in the leadership. And five, lack of infrastructure. And then they tried to describe Christ-centered leadership or the Jesus style of leadership. And they all agreed on 5 points: integrity, number one. Number two, authenticity in the ministry. Three, character, the character of the leaders. A servant's heart, number four. And number five, humility. Isn't that interesting? It goes right along with what we said. Now, respondents chose the five following frequent causes of failure in Christian leaders. Five causes of failure in Christian leaders. Number one, burnout. Number two, abuse of power. Number three, inappropriate use of finances. Number four, inordinate pride. And number five, lack of growth in spiritual life. Boy, that's something that I'm concerned about. Lack of growth in spiritual life and of a leader. And if you go to our website, biblicalfellowship.com, I have 3 or 4 messages on you're either stagnating or you're growing. You're either going forward or backwards. Paul said to Timothy, let all see your progress. The key to your influencing others and being contagious for Christ is that you're growing and you're learning and you're reading and you're pressing forward and you're listening. Now, we're going to today connect love and leadership. And we'll look at 1 Corinthians 13. Love is indispensable to leaders and their teachers. The Bible literally is a book of love. And should it not be? Because God is... That's weak. God is...
Love.
All right, it's a little bit better. But of course, you're tired. You're tired. This conference has worn you down. Jesus Christ said the greatest commandment is to love God with your entire being and to love your neighbor as yourself. Christ said that. He laid the foundation. Now, Christian leaders don't normally focus on love when they address leadership. They address, and there's much good material written describing leadership as leadership qualities of courage, resourcefulness, charisma, conviction, perseverance, visionary thinking, self-discipline, decisiveness. I've not read anything that says love is an essential ingredient to Christian leadership. But the New Testament is crystal clear. We're going to see it right now. Love is indispensable to your leadership. You're a noisy gong and a clanging cymbal if your leadership is not marked by the kind of love we will look at right now. So Christian leaders normally don't focus on love. We're going to do that. Second, Christian leaders and teachers set the spiritual tone of a church. Tone is so important. The culture, the atmosphere, the spirit of the church. Leaders set that tone. It could be very critical, very self-righteous, very cold. It could be a fighting atmosphere, unloving, joyless. Or a church could be alive with joy and generosity and welcoming and bearing one another's burdens, an exciting place to be. There's nothing like being in a church that's full of joy and excitement. People just love getting together. Nothing like it. Well, my dear friends, leaders set the tone for the church. Third, in the church family, people must work closely together as brothers and sisters to make decisions and accomplish tasks. You can't do this without love. You know, church is run by committees and meetings, group settings, elders and deacons meetings, staff meetings, board meetings, committee meetings, all church meetings. And the more you meet, the longer you're with one another, you get to know one another's fatal flaws and annoying traits that are driving you to madness. You get to know these things. How in the world are you going to live together without killing one another? It's only by the more excellent way. So let's turn in our notes now, turn in our Bibles to 1 Corinthians 13. And we want to look at Paul's teaching. He says to the Corinthians, I'm going to show you, Corinthians, you independent-minded, proud, self-centered group of people, I'm going to show you the more excellent way. And I said to you earlier today, that's my heart's passion, the more excellent way. And everything you do is to be done according to the more excellent way. So he says here, he starts out with, love is indispensable to leading and teaching the Lord's people, the more excellent way. And I will show you a still more excellent way. Now, I want to remind you of something. Here's the problem in the church. The problem in this church was pride. It was selfishness. They were really proud of their knowledge. They were proud of their wisdom. They were proud of their spiritual experiences. And Paul says, there's actually something more excellent than gifts, more excellent than your service and your highfalutin knowledge. I'm going to show you now the more excellent way. So the first thing he says is the indispensability of love. Let me repeat that to you. Verses 1 to 3, the indispensability of love to everything you do. Notice the first thing he says here in your text here. If I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I'm a noisy gong and a clanging cymbal. Now, the purpose of spiritual gifts, what they were very interested in, we should be interested in spiritual gifts, it's a marvelous doctrine. Every single believer has some gift or gifts. God has given you his grace to serve him. They're meant to build up the church and to unite the church. Yet the Corinthians, in their enthusiasm for spiritual gifts, were using gifts to vaunt themselves. They were causing divisions with gifts. They were hurting one another. It was for ego gratification and dividing the body. And so Paul uses all his rhetorical, powerful skills now to wake up this group, shake them hard. They don't realize they lack love. Here they are, full of themselves, full of knowledge. They don't realize they're in serious trouble. So to shake them real hard, we have this magnificent passage. And let me remind you, Paul's not writing a wedding ceremony. He's not giving a poem to love. He is instructing a church in crisis that's divisive and fighting one another. There's strife in the church, anger in the church, jealousy in the church. This passage addresses conflict. Now, to correct their distortions, he pictures himself hypothetically as the world's most gifted tongue speaker. They were very enthused about tongues. They were using it, though, to say of their higher spiritual experiences. And he says, well, if I spoke with the tongues of men and angels, but if I didn't have love, I would be, is this annoying you? No, okay. If I spoke with the tongues of men and angels, and I didn't have love, are you getting annoyed by now? Are you? Should I keep this up? No? No? What's the problem? I'm such a spiritual man. What about you? Should I keep this up? You getting annoyed? Well, that's what it's like when you serve God without love. You're annoying. And not only are you annoying, I guarantee you will hurt people because you're all about you. That's what Paul says. But notice what he really says. He says, not just this is annoying, he says, I, notice that, I am a noisy gong and a clanging cymbal. I'm not what I should be. There's a serious deficiency in my Christian life. It's loveless tongue speaking. It's not the more excellent way. And then the next thing he says is, if I know all mysteries, hypothetically, he says, if I have the gift of prophecy to such a full measure that I have all mysteries and all knowledge. In other words, he's a walking, talking encyclopedia of the Bible. He knows it all theologically. He's written a systematic theology. He's written the dogmatics. He knows it all. He's proud of his learning. He's proud of his superior knowledge. This is a big one. If you have knowledge, you learn Greek, you learn Hebrew, you've read Karl Barth, you have read Berkauer, you have read the systematic theologies, you pretty much know it all. You have a PhD, two PhDs. Sometimes people get two PhDs. I wonder, what are they doing, wasting their life in school all their life? And you don't have love, I guarantee you, that knowledge will cause damage to people. I guarantee you, you'll probably divide a church because you will be self-superior. You know what 1 Corinthians 8:1 says? Knowledge puffs up, it inflates. When you study and you study and you know it all, your head gets so big that it almost falls off your shoulders. You have a big head and a little heart, and you want to go around and impress people with your Greek texts. I read Greek. You see that with the seminary students. They come to our church. They have their Greek texts right under here. Yeah. I read Greek. I know they don't read Greek, but they want you to know. I had 6 months of Greek. I know the alphabet. It's not a joke. It's true. It's true. Oh, knowledge. It puffs up. It fills up the head. And you know what it leads to? Intellectual snobbery. An attitude of mockery and fun making of other people's views. A spirit of contempt for those of lesser knowledge. And a demeaning way of dealing with people. If you have a lot of knowledge, one of the most important things to do in your church is not to show off your knowledge. It intimidates and threatens people. They will never be honest with you. Well, how can I say anything? He knows Greek. Or worse, he knows Hebrew. Ooh, he must really be smart. It's loveless scholarship, loveless learning. Very, very dangerous. Loveless faith. Loveless prophecy account for some of the most tragic pages in the Christian story through the ages. It has burned so-called heretics. It has stultified the sincere quest for truth. It has often been contemptuous and embittered. It's often issued in denial of Christian brotherhood to fellow Christians. Knowledge without love, without motivating power uncolored by love, is a dangerous thing. It's like fire. That's why so often young people coming out of seminary and places like that, if they don't understand their real limit in knowledge, how little they really have in their head, they're going to show off. And then love, without love, risk-taking faith, he says, is worthless. The third spiritual gift Paul speaks of is faith. He imagines himself possessing the most excellent gift of faith imaginable, so as he can remove mountains. He's a virtual George Mueller. He's an Abraham believing God for the impossible. He's a powerhouse of prayer. He takes risk-taking faith. But if it's not colored by love, it's nothing. It's spiritual bankruptcy. Seeking just praise for self. And then fourth, he says, without love, giving all one's money to the poor is actually unprofitable. Paul next postulates about giving away all his worldly possessions, his home, his furniture, his property, his savings, his most cherished possessions. He gives it all away to feed the poor. He gives it all. He reduces himself to complete poverty. Surely this is altruistic action. Surely this is love. Surely, no. You can do that without love. Can you believe that? Remember Ananias and Sapphira, Acts chapter 5? They pretended to sell this land and then come and give to the poor. Was it motivated by love? Oh, no, it wasn't motivated by love at all. It was motivated to get praise of men, personal prestige in the sight of the church. It was actually hypocritical love. The inner motivation was to see themselves lifted up and exalted and elevated like a Barnabas. People said all these wonderful things about Barnabas, and they wanted people to pat them on the back. They wanted to go around and be known as the big givers in the church. Oh, Ananias and Sapphira, did you see them? They're the big givers. Oh, they're generous. But they were actually thieves. You can give, and you can give a lot, but if it's not done in love, it's spiritual bankruptcy. You just waste. Keep your money. Keep your money. It's worthless. It's useless. It's of no value to God. Then fifth, the ultimate sacrifice of one's life is pointless if it's not done with love. Paul envisions himself as the ultimate hero of the faith. In an act of supreme sacrifice, he surrenders his body to the painful flames of martyrdom for Christ. Total dedication, courage. But it can be done for the wrong reasons. Again, for pride. You may not know this, but in the second century, to be a martyr for Christ actually gains you a great deal of fame and adulation. It was said of Polycarp that his bones were more valuable than precious stones and finer than refined gold. So you can do all these things, and really you do it for yourself because you want to be remembered. You want to be in the hall of faith. You want people going around saying, boy, that Ben, what a guy. Listen to what Jonathan Edwards writes. God delights in little things when they spring from sincere love to himself. A cup of cold water given to a disciple in sincere love is worth more in God's sight than all one's goods given to feed the poor, yea, than the wealth of a kingdom given away or a body offered up in the flames without love. Now, verses 1 to 3 give us the indispensable nature of love for whatever you do. Now, if love is that important, if it's that important, what is it? Don't you think that's a good question? What is it? What does it look like? What does it not look like? So now in verses 4 to 7, he's going to give you the finest description we have in the New Testament of the virtues of love, the many aspects of love. Nothing like this in literature. It's very powerful. I want to apply it to our leadership because Paul says, no matter what you do, whatever gift you have the gift of teaching, you have the gift of leading, you're in a position of power and authority in the church, then it has to be exercised in love or it's worthless. You will divide the church, I guarantee. You will not develop the people. You'll just push yourself forward. Let's look at these amazing qualities of love, and they all can be called qualities of Christ-like love or vices. All right, first thing he says is this: love is patient, or some of your Bibles say love long-suffering, suffers long, forbearing. If you were to ask the Lord, Lord, what is the first quality of love? The Lord would say long-suffering, forbearance. You can't beat the King James here. Love suffers long. That's the idea here. Love suffers long, particularly in respect to injuries suffered. The true spirit of love is slow to retaliate to personal wrongs suffered. Now, let me remind you, this word is used of God throughout the Bible. God is long-suffering. So when you're tempted not to be long-suffering with the people you lead, just remember, God is long-suffering with you and all your problems and all your many failures. That's how he treats you. So you should treat others the same way, with long-suffering. It's a quality of Christ. It's a quality of God, and it should be a quality of every leader, that love is forbearing. It's very, very patient with people. A lack of patience in a Christian leader is actually a serious deficiency, because our work is a spiritual work with people. We're in the people business. And when you work with people, you just can't kick them around. You ever see what an impatient father is like? Well, they're very grouchy. They snap at their children all the time. They even hit their children. They have no patience. That's a bad father. A good father is understanding and forbearing with the craziness of children. Oh, boy. I have 7 grandsons, and they're crazy. Oh, boy. One day, I said to my wife, I said, "Dear, I do not hear the boys. Where are they?" She says, "I don't know." I said, "Well, we better find them. Whenever you don't hear something, you know, with boys, trouble." So I'm looking for them, and here they are in the front of the house with their bows, shooting arrows over my house to the back. Now, that's bad. That's bad. But here's why it's bad. Because in the back of our house, there's a family with one little girl. And they think this is the only girl in the world. And about 2 years before, one of my boys threw a rock over and hit her right in the head. Just about broke up the whole neighborhood. So I had to bow down and crawl up my hands and knees to get forgiveness. If that neighbor saw those arrows coming over the house, she would just call the fire department, the police, the FBI, the CIA, everything else, and had them there. Maybe burned our house to the ground. I don't know. Oh, you have to be so patient. Give me the patience, Lord. Okay. You have to be patient because life is full of frustrations and hurts and injustices. People will assail their leaders. They'll criticize their decisions. They'll speak evil behind their back. They'll take advantage of you. Take in your Bibles right now. But Ben, I don't know when I'm supposed to stop. When am I supposed to stop? Tell me the truth. 5:20. 5:20? Oh, what happened to the time? It went so quickly. All right, I'm going to have to pick up. I may not finish all these, but that's okay because you got a free book. Everything's free here. I love this place. Turn to 2 Timothy. It's more important I cover some of these key ones. Now, my brothers and sisters, if you're in leadership, and particularly if you're a teacher, which is the context here, you must know these verses. You must know these verses, and they must guide you. All right, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24. In my mind, I've probably through my lifetime quoted this to myself 1,000 times or more. The Lord's servant, that's bond servant, the Lord's slave, and the context is one who's a teacher, but it applies to all leadership, and actually applies to any time we're leading people. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach. That's how you deal with many problems. patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. It's interesting how much gentleness is mentioned. Notice what this verse says. The Lord's servant, he cannot be quarrelsome. He's kind, our next virtue here. And he's patiently enduring evil. That's exactly what this virtue is. If you are going to be a Christian leader, you are going to have to be patient. You're going to deal with people's weaknesses and failures. You're going to deal with people who are slow to learn, resistant to change, weak in the faith, forgetful of their responsibilities, quick to complain. Now, when I say love is patient, I do not mean passivity. Passivity is an enemy to all leadership. Paul was patient with the Corinthians. He didn't give up on them. He didn't cut them off. He didn't strike back. He didn't return evil for evil. He didn't express anger towards them. He was not passive, but he was patient with them. Then next, love is kind. Oh, love is kind. You can no more have love without kindness than you have springtime without flowers. What is kindness? Kindness is the readiness to do good, to help, to relieve burdens, to be useful, to serve, to be merciful, to be tender, to be sympathetic to others. I love the definition. Kindness is love in work clothes. Do you know the power of kindness? Kindness impacts people in a tremendous way. Little acts of kindness influence people. It captures their attention. A card sent to someone in sick. Wow, that's so important. A concerned phone call. An invitation to dinner. A readiness to help relieve a burden. A caring voice. A touch. A thoughtful gesture. A simple expression of interest in another person's concern. A visit. The way of kindness is the most excellent way. Patience is the more excellent way. I have found in my own ministry, little things matter. Just a little touch on someone's shoulder and rubbing their shoulder when you know they're suffering, you know. We have now several people die in our church. One's a young mommy. Oh, and I try to write her regularly an email and give her a scripture. And so I wrote it just before I came. I said, can Meryl and I visit you when we get back? Because she lives 60 miles away. She used to be in our church. Her dad and mom are in our church. And she wrote, please come see me. Little things. Powerful to influence people. That's the path of love. That's the more excellent way. But the self-centered person, they're just wondering what you're going to do for them. A right voice. Phone calls. We do phone calls every day. My wife, she helps me, a great help to me. She'll every night make phone calls. Just calling people suffering, family problems, marital problems, physical problems, whatever. That means a lot to people. And a note. The power of a note to people. And always give scripture when you send a note. Very, very important to leadership. So these two beautiful positive virtues, and they're sort of the different sides of the same coin. What is love? What is love? It is long-suffering. It is forbearing. It suffers long, even when hurt. And it is kind. Learn the power of kindness. Be a kind leader. That's a loving leader. Don't be a cold, aloof, ride in with your white horse type of leader. Here's a great word. You want a great word? Are you ready for a great word? Yeah. Approachable. Approachable. That's a great word. You should be approachable. People feel very comfortable to come to you. There's a problem. There's an issue. They know, don't go to those people. They get yelled at. They'll be pushed off, but I go to this person. They're approachable with whatever I have. It's very important with your children to be approachable. Children should not feel I can't say anything to dad. Approachable. Now, he gives these two positive virtues, and then he switches to eight negative ones. What love is not. Now, when I wrote the book, Leading with Love, I was struggling. I struggled for quite a while. Why eight? I'd rather him keep going with positive ones. Now, if he lists negative ones, there's a positive side to it. We'll look at that. Why eight negative statements about love? Love is not this. Well, the answer is this. All these eight negative statements are the self-centered life, the opposite of love, and they're the problems in the church at Corinth. So basically, he's dealing with the issues in the church. Every one of these eight negative statements tells us something about the problems in the church, why there was so much division, why there was this fighting, why there's this arrogance in the church. It's a self-centered life, all incompatible with real love. So let's look at them very quickly here. All right, love does not envy. Top of the list, usually the beginning of the list gives you your key word. Jealousy, someone has said, is the special sins of the people of God. You see it all through the Old Testament. And you see how ugly jealousy is. Basically, Cain killed his brother because he's jealous. Joseph's brothers threw him in a pit because they were jealous of him. Saul tried to kill David because he was jealous of him. We're told that they were jealous of Christ, jealous of Paul. Jealousy has wrecked countless relationships and split many churches. Envy makes us resentful of others' good fortune. It covets others' gifts, possessions, and position of influence. It makes us suspicious and critical of other people's popularity. The greatest example in the Old Testament is David and Saul. If Saul was thinking, he would say, God gave me a great gift in David. He's such a powerful military leader. The people love him. What a gift to my kingdom. Instead, when the people said Saul killed 1,000, David killed 10,000, he became insane and paranoid with jealousy, threw spears at him, tried to kill him, passed rumors about him. He was insane. He was out of his mind with jealousy. He had to kill this young man. Get rid of them. How about in a church? A pastor told me one time his church being torn apart by the choir. How come I don't get to do the solos? How come I don't play first trumpet? I'm a better trumpet player. I'm a lot better singer than those other singers that are always singing all the time. In fact, you don't know what they're like. They're creeps. Oh man, jealousy's crazy. Read what Proverbs says about it. But that's not love. Love is large-hearted, other-oriented, content, full of goodwill towards other people. When love sees someone who is popular, successful, beautiful, talented, it's glad and never jealous. Love rejoices in that. Oh, what a beautiful virtue is love. Love wants to promote other people. It wants to see the good in others and glad for it. And so when the other person gets to sing these solos, it says, I'm so happy for that person. I know it means a lot to them. Even if I'm a little bit better singer, I'm happy for them. They need this more than me. Here's a great virtue of love. Love is understanding. Isn't that beautiful? Love understands people. It understands situations. Then, love does not boast, does not boast. Bragging is a sinful preoccupation with oneself. One time I had a missionary to my house, and when he was speaking on Sunday morning, I already knew there was a problem. So anyway, we had him over our house Sunday morning after, usually after church, we have people over to eat, one of our favorite times. For 3 hours, this missionary, with other people there, bragged and talked about himself. I've been here. I've been there. I know this person. I've written this. I've spoken here. Not one time in 3 hours did he ever ask anyone at the table about themselves. I was actually almost physically ill. He never came back to our church. Even when he was speaking, I noticed when he was speaking, it was all about him. The Bible says, let another praise you and not your own mouth, a stranger and not your own lips. Braggarts build up themselves. Jealous people tear others down, but loving people are always building others up. In fact, a loving person does not stand around and boast of self or brag of self. It promotes and praises others. It's self-effacing. It shies from seeking itself. It delights in focusing its attention on others and pushing others to the center of stage. Love says, hey, we got two spotlights here. We got four spotlights here. Missionary who I knew very, very well in my home numerous times, he was on a ship back to Africa. Been in Africa 60 years, a missionary. His wife is one of the world's leading experts, they're all dead now, in the pygmy language. First people to reach the pygmies, as far as I know. On the boat was Billy Graham. And so he had to spend time with Billy Graham. Can you imagine that? And Billy Graham, by this time, was world-renowned. And I said to him, well, what was your time like with Billy Graham? He said, Billy Graham addressed almost everything to me. He wanted to know what I was doing. He wanted to know what Africa was like. And he basically questioned me to death, directed everything to me. And so when I said to him, Billy, what can I pray for you? He said, pray that I'll be humble. Pray that I'll be humble. Isn't that beautiful? You see, people that always have to tell you about all that they've achieved are braggarts. The Corinthians were braggarts, just like their culture, people in their culture. When you're with people, show interest in them. Ask them a lot of questions. Show them that you care about them and not just tell them all your accolades. Third, love is not arrogant. It's not arrogant. Now, these should all be the virtues of a good leader in a church. This is what it is to lead with love. This is the more excellent way of leadership. Love is not arrogant. Arrogant spirit permeated the church. In fact, this word puffed up is used six times there. Amy Carmichael said, those who think too much of themselves don't think enough. Arrogant means to be puffed up, to be inflated. J.B. Phillips says, love does not cherish an inflated ideas of its own importance. It doesn't have a superiority complex like Diotrephes, who loved to be first. That's what the Bible says. He loves the first place. Diotrephes was not a builder of people, but a limiter of people. He was not a uniter, but a divider. Exact opposite of what a Christian leader should be. Notice love on the positive side. Love is to be humble and modest. Love thinks humbly and modestly about oneself. Romans 12:3. Romans 12:16. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be conceited. And then 1 Peter 5:5. I love this verse. Clothe yourself, all of you, elders, younger men, that's who he's speaking to, with humility. Do not come to church improperly dressed. Dress properly for church. Clothe yourself with the clothes of humility. Then you're properly dressed. Elders, clothe yourself with humility. Young men who fight with the elders, clothe yourself in humility, one towards another. Or don't come. Don't clothe yourself with arrogance, self-importance. You're superior. You're smarter. You're more holy. You're more dedicated. Here's the importance of humility. Humility makes a leader more teachable. Humility makes one more receptive to constructive criticism and not snap back. Better able to submit and work with other people. Better qualified to deal with sins and failures of other people. Less prone to fight. Quicker to reconcile differences. Really, without humility, you cannot be a Christ-like leader. You'll be one of these people who were surveyed by the people in Cape Town saying pride is our great problem among our leaders. Fourth, love is not rude. Let me just make a quick statement. Rude means doesn't behave in an ill-mannered impropriety. Behaving with ill-mannered impropriety. In other words, love is concerned about the little things. Rudeness is acting disgracefully, contrary to established norms, proper conduct, decency, inappropriate dress, inconsistent talk, inconsiderable talk. I better give up. Regarding other people's time, disregarding other people's time, taking advantage of people, tactlessness, ignoring contributions of others or their ideas, running roughshod over other people's plans, inappropriate behavior to the opposite sex. In other words, it's polite. It's tactful. It's very sensitive to these little things. Other people are talking. You're in an elders meeting. Other people are talking. You just talk right over them. You don't even listen. Brush them aside. That's what I say is what's important. You're not a good listener at all. In Western society, we are becoming more coarse. Maybe you've noticed that on the radio. Maybe you've noticed that in magazines or in these talking heads on TV. Very coarse, very rude. It's almost popular to be rude and just put people down and shout people down. Everything's black and white. I'm the leader. Listen to me. People love it. They undoubtedly love it. These powerful, powerful personalities. Just brush you aside. Love is not rude. It's not impolite. When you're in a meeting, be a good listener. Listen to other people's opinions. Listen to what they have to say. Be careful how you dress. Do not be offensive to other people. Don't just step in front of people. Open the door for people. When there needs to be coffee time, let others go first. Or in our church, let the children have the donuts first. Although the adults are standing there going, chocolate donuts. The little kids will eat all those chocolate donuts. The rotten little kids. Of course, you'll see a parent just sort of push through. Going, get out of the way, you kids. Love is not selfish. It's not selfish. Remember the James and John story? Lord, grant us to sit at your right hand and one at your left in your glory. Total card-carrying, self-centered people. The other 10 got indignant with them, the Bible says. You know why they were indignant with James and John? They wanted thrones. They were all fighting for thrones. I mean, think about it. It's sort of humorous in a sense. Lord, don't listen to these other 10. We want to sit on your right hand and on your left hand when you come to your kingdom. We want the glory. And the others go, who do those two people think they are? So Jesus answers them, James and John wants to sit on thrones in power and glory. Jesus knows that he must hang on a cross in weakness and shame. The antithesis is total. He says, yes, you don't know really what you're talking about, but I will let you drink of the cup of suffering. You will die. James dies very early. You can suffer. You can be shamefully treated. But to sit on thrones is not mine to give you. Love is not preoccupied with self. It does not insist on its own way. In our age of radical individualism, this is very much understood. I think of Barnabas. What a beautiful man. The first time we see Barnabas, he's giving financially. But here's the thing that's neat about Barnabas. We see Barnabas in a powerful ministry at the center of the ministry in Antioch. The 12 apostles send him there. He's a big shot. The 12 apostles sent me to Antioch. Check out the situation. He's looking over the situation in Antioch. And he says, Antioch needs Paul. I'm going to find Paul and bring him here. He brings another man into the ministry who's far more powerful than he is. But that's because he's concerned about the people and the ministry in Antioch. And Paul is what they need. Paul is what they will get. In other words, Barnabas was not a ministry hog. Barnabas was not a throne seeker. He was a washer of feet. He was a lifter of people, not a limiter of people. He was a giver, not a taker. Someone has said, love is the giving variety, not the getting variety. He was a Philippians 2 leader. Beautiful example of promoting others. You are what Antioch needs. I'll take second place. More concerned about the work, more concerned about the glory of God than himself. And then it says, love is not easily provoked. This is a remarkable quality about love. It's not easily provoked to an emotional state of irritability or anger. It's not irritable. In leadership, in dealing with people, there are many provoking situations. There are many things that will fuel your anger, your irritability, your offense, your bitterness, your resentment. That's why Titus 1:7 says a leader cannot be quick-tempered. There's going to be plenty of fuel to light off your bomb inside you. Jonathan Edwards wrote, the heart of man is exceedingly prone to undue and sinful anger, being full of pride and selfishness. I am convinced that much of the disasters in our church, the divisions in our church, the harsh feelings in our church are ignited by uncontrolled anger. The work of the flesh, fits of anger, the work of the flesh. The work of the Spirit is self-control. When debate happens, when conflict happens, when hurt happens, the first thing you must do is control that spirit of anger. All fits of anger, and that's what the Bible calls it, fits of anger, hostility, are the work of the flesh, not the spirit. And we're to be spirit-controlled people and not flesh-controlled people. James says, great advice, in conflict, let every person be slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness that God requires. You are not going to get the work of God done by your anger. You're going to do a lot of damage to people. Long-term damage. You yell at people. You eyeball them with your big glaring eyes. You stamp. You push them aside. You humiliate them with your anger. You will do long-term, lifelong damage that people will never forget. Don't do the work of God with your anger. And if you hurt someone with your anger, be there at the front door to apologize. Say, I am very sorry. That was not the spirit. That was the flesh. Very damaging to the work of God. Uncontrolled anger. And uncontrolled anger, in fact, Paul says this. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. Be angry, but don't let the sun go down on your anger. In other words, deal with your anger right away, properly and quickly. If not, you give the devil a place, an opportunity. In other words, the devil will use your anger to do much worse damage. He's right there to use that angry spirit, which is the flesh and not the spirit. Do not do the work of God with your anger. And if you have an anger problem, you've got to be praying about grace every day to control it. Some people just struggle with anger more than other people. And I will tell you, that angry spirit has destroyed families, destroyed little children. A little child is very tender, and to scream or yell at a child or smack a child is abhorrent. Fathers should be patient with children. Always explain discipline. Control your anger first. Well, these are the marvelous virtues of a Christian leader. This will put you on a different level. You can finish these virtues in the book you just received, Leading with Love.
We hope you enjoyed this message. Biola University offers a variety of biblically-centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Learn more at biola.edu.